lead on him. He's been shot.
Has he stopped breathing?
Has he stopped breathing? Yes. Yes, they say he has. If you don't hurry, he's gone.
Chris Lane was an Australian rising sports star, a talented baseballer on an American college scholarship.
Because a scholarship to an American college, big deal.
Yeah. Big deal.
Yeah.
So how can the mother say, no, don't go?
Very quickly, he fell for you.
Yeah.
Any aspirations of being a pro ball player sometime?
I don't know. If I can stay away from the beers, we'll wait and see, but never know if party gets away some days.
All right, there we go. Okay, mate, good to see you. All right, man.
He was living his dream.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
I just felt like it was a dark cloud, like a premonition that something bad was going to happen.
They were 15, 16, and 17.
Mm-hmm. Hunted.
They would have been chasing him.
Chased down.
They intended to shoot him and kill him.
Ruthlessly murdered for no apparent reason.
So Chris was only this far away.
Christopher stumbles across the road.
And I seen him grabbing his bag.
Help me.
That's stupid.
So why did this young Aussie have to die? Why was Chris Lane murdered in cold blood? In a world-exclusive investigation, we confront one of the killers.
I think it's important. You obviously know who that is. You ready to tell us the truth? Tell us about Chris as a baby.
Full of warmth. Yeah, just gorgeous.
You had three girls already in the family, then along comes Chris.
Boy, girl, didn't matter to me. It was just another good, healthy kid, and that was the main thing.
Do you remember when he took his first steps?
Yes, I do. Only to be knocked down. Straight away, because Erin wouldn't have it. Erin, who is a little bit older, just was like, you know, that's not going to work because now you can move and run away from me.
You actually pushed him over to stop him.
It didn't work, did it? He got there. I think that for me has, in some ways, that's been the hardest thing because I don't have anyone left to compete with.
The three big sisters.
Yep.
How lucky was Chris?
He would have said we were the lucky ones.
Born in Melbourne, outnumbered 3-1 by his big sisters, Chris Lane was the much-loved son of Donna and Peter, their active baby boy who from a very early age just loved sport.
He was always ball-focused as a kid in terms of even before he could walk.
Over in the middle of America, in Duncan, Oklahoma, boys of a similar age were growing up in God-fearing homes in the oil-rich town. Boys like Michael Jones.
Michael was your miracle baby, wasn't he?
He was a surprise.
What kind of child was he?
Rowdy. Active. He was always small for his age. As you can see him, he's not a little tall boy anyway.
No one wanted to wrestle with him because he was undefeated for 2 years.
Come on,
Another young wrestler from the same part of town was Chansey Luna. Son to a white mother and an African-American father.
Chansey, he was sport rotten. He was sport. He was pretty much mama's boy. I mean, he was just a happy boy.
Smile, Chansey! All right!
You know, I never did have any problem with him. I had less problem with him than I did my own kids.
Joseph, you ready? Run! Come on, Chansey, run!
There was hardly any day that he was in a bad mood.
And he loved sport?
Yes, he loved sports.
In small town Duncan, baseball is a big deal. And Chansey Luna, like most kids in town, grew up playing it. He was good at America's game. And in Australia, so too was Chris Lane. Chris discovered baseball after being introduced to T-ball as a kid.
It wasn't just the sport, though, no. It was the team. You know, we play together, we win together, we lose together, but whatever we do together. And I think that was so important for him.
He was a very personable guy. He made friends with just about anybody and everybody, anytime.
There was lots of my girlfriends that were kind of like, oh, how's Chris doing? And I was like, I don't know. He's my brother.
Chris's cheekiness masked his determination to succeed at his chosen sport. And in 2008, his desire and hard work paid off when Redlands, a college 40 minutes drive from Oklahoma City, offered the then 17-year-old a baseball scholarship.
Because a scholarship to an American college, big deal.
Yeah. Big deal. Yeah, so how can the mother say, no, don't go?
We've been told that he was very keen to go over and test out his Australian accent on a lot of American women.
Back at the ballpark in Arlington, we head to the six. Rangers leading the Mariners now 7-2. And Dave and Tom, a first here. First off, this is Chris taking his very first Major League game from Australia. What's ironic about this, he actually plays baseball, college baseball. How did this come about? A guy from Australia and taking in your very first Major League game, how'd this come about?
Yeah, hey, mate. I basically started playing T-ball when I was younger and eventually got a little older and started calling a couple schools over here. And next thing you know, I was over in Oklahoma playing a bit of baseball and down here back in watching a bit of Texas Rangers.
I think he's sort of a whole new arena to entertain people, to tell stories that probably were half-truths. And I'm led to believe that the Australian accent gave him, you know, 90% of his in most of the time.
Any aspirations of being a pro ball player sometime?
I don't know. If I can stay away from the beers, we'll wait and see, but never know, partying gets in the way some days.
All right, there we go. Good day, mate. Good Cheers, to see you. Man. All right, man.
He was living his dream.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. And then he fell in love.
In Oklahoma, in his first year at Redlands College, Chris Lane met Sarah Harper, who was there on a golf scholarship. Duncan is Sarah's hometown. It's 90 minutes ride from the college.
Was there an immediate attraction, do you think, between the two of you?
Well, yeah. I mean, we got along really well. Our personalities matched pretty good.
Because you knocked him back a few times, didn't you?
Yeah.
You made him work pretty hard.
Yeah, I wasn't really into the whole let's just start dating thing.
He was persistent.
Yes. He's a very persistent person.
Do you remember when he first told you that he'd met Sarah?
On Skype. And he was chatting to me and there was, and looked like he was in bed. There was someone next to him.
Uh-oh.
And I'm saying, so Chris, who's in the room with you? No, I'm just here on my own. Thinking, no, you're not.
And all of a sudden we sort of had, you know, a little face in the background that was a girl and Mum was sort of,
there.
Is there someone with him? And he's like, yeah, this is Sarah. And she's like, hi, and we're kind of like,
said, oh, you know, this is Sarah. I'm like, oh, and I thought, well, what's happening here? I was a bit concerned, but yeah, she's gorgeous.
All I ever heard about was this good-looking bird who was an amazing golfer, and for me, that was I was just wrapped that he was in that position, you know, like he was happy.
He laid eyes on you, and that was it. He was done.
Yeah, I guess so. He's an attachment person.
As Sarah and Chris were finding happiness together, over in Duncan, once happy-go-lucky boys were finding themselves in and out of trouble.
This is what happens when you disrespect niggas in the hood and shit, nigga. Look at this. Look how they did, cuz. Look, busted the windows out. Look, my nigga, this is sad, my nigga. This shit's terrible. Look.
Michael Jones had taken up with the wrong crowd.
You could tell he was hanging out with the wrong kids.
Making bad decisions. Doing things you wouldn't normally do.
Among the bad company he kept was Chancey Luna, who Michael had known since they were tiny.
Me and Chancey were real young. We hung out a lot in my sophomore year. He started selling dope, and I started smoking dope. And that's how we started hanging out. He was my dope man.
16-year-old Chancey Luna had had a tragic 18 months. His father, an absentee father at best, was jailed for dealing drugs. His stepfather was killed in a motorbike accident. And on Christmas Day 2012, his brother died suddenly after being rushed to hospital.
He started distancing himself from everybody.
Depression.
Because, I mean, him and his older brother were really close.
Chancey about to imitate Malik.
This is between me and him.
It said that he was running with a gang. Was that true?
This is a wannabe gang down here. They're just a bunch of boys acting stupid, trying to act all big and stuff.
Chancey Luna was friends with another wannabe tough, 15-year-old James Bug Edwards. Edwards was well known in Duncan for all the wrong reasons.
Yeah, he just, He liked to intimidate people. I mean, the boy, he thought he was tall, rock, bulletproof, you know?
I said, you can hang around the wrong people and you're gonna get caught up right on with them.
I just felt like it was a dark cloud, like a premonition that something bad was gonna happen. And I asked my wife, I said, you know, I just feel something's fixing to happen. She said, I kind of feel it too.
But of course, Sarah and Chris knew none of this. They were simply enjoying their time together. Their relationship was blossoming.
Who said the love word first?
He did.
Yeah?
Yes.
It was when Chris began planning a visit to Australia for Sarah to meet his family that his mum realised how serious he was about her.
We'd organised a trip for them, both of them, to go to Cairns. And we're online, I was sort of saying, oh, what about this hotel and that hotel? And, you know, I was going for the cheaper options. And he's saying to me, no, Sarah, she wants to, you know, she needs to stay at a fancy hotel. And I'm going, well, really? You know, we're shouting, it's, you know, are you sure? And he said, I want her to. And I thought, wow, like, you love her. You want to look after her. That was really impressive.
And he had grown into a really fine young guy. He'd found his balance, he'd found his position, and Sarah was part of that.
So when I went home, as I was leaving, he gave me a cuddle and he said, don't worry, I'll be back. So I said, love you. He said, love you. And I left. And that was it.
Last time you'd see him.
On Tuesday, the 13th of August, Chris and Sarah went to Melbourne's Tullamarine Airport for the long haul back to Oklahoma. Two hours northeast of Duncan, Oklahoma, is Davis Correctional Facility.
Yeah, Dale, and camera crew.
Thank you, sir.
Permission for this interview has taken months to arrange. The man I've come to meet is Michael Jones.
Okay.
Jones was 17 when he drove the car that hunted down the 22-year-old Australian, Chris Lane.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
This is the first interview Jones has given.
Okay. Right, let's go.
August 16th today, temperatures right now, it's dry outside. It's going to be very favorable for outdoor activities. We're going to have a really nice
It was a pretty day outside. It was hot. August in Oklahoma is hot.
The joke generally is, well, you know, it's going to be hot enough today to go outside and fry an egg on the concrete.
It was really hot. It was one of the hotter days, I think, that week.
How do you remember that day starting?
Well, I remember the day starting actually on the 15th because I didn't go to sleep the night of the 15th. We were at a friend's house. He was partying. Me and my cousins were smoking methamphetamines. Chancey and James didn't have no part of that. But we stayed up all night, and then about 6:30 in the morning, Chancey said he needed to go home because his mom didn't know he was gone. So me and my cousin took him home.
So Chancey was in bed when you left?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
5 minutes' drive away, Chris Lane and Sarah Harper had stayed the night at Sarah's parents' place. Both were exhausted after their long flight home from Australia.
What do you remember about that day when you woke up? Did you just sleep in, your jet lag?
No, we woke up probably around 8 in the morning, and then we just hung out and watched TV for a while.
The day that everything happened, he drove me to work in my pickup.
At 12 o'clock noon, I had to take him to the yard where he worked.
It was like any other day, I guess. It was, you know, a good day. I was getting to be with my son.
All right, Michael.
Dropped me off and stood there and talked to me and said bye to me and hugged me and drove my pickup home. Got in his car. Last time I really got to hold him or hug him.
And I dropped him off and took his pickup, went and picked up Chancey, and then went over to Kendall's house and where Bug was at. We left there and went to a store, and I bought a cigarillo so he could roll up some weed.
At almost that exact time, Chris and Sarah were returning to her parents' place after picking up some supplies at the local Walmart. Sarah had a part-time job in the pro shop at the golf club. Chris said he'd pick her up after work, and in the meantime, he'd pack for college and go for a run.
He, for some reason, really liked the idea of running at the hottest part of the day, which I'd never understood, but he went a little farther because that was slightly uphill, and so I guess he wanted to get a good run in before going back to school.
It was a beautiful day outside. That's the reason he was running. He was just an innocent person running down the street.
But his route took him past this house, past Michael Jones, Chancey Luna, and Bug Edwards.
He would have jogged right next to the house where Luna and Jones picked up Edwards. I firmly believe that they saw him jog past while they were in the driveway.
I did see him going down the street, and maybe 5 minutes, the black car left with the three guys. They weren't speeding, they just pulled out.
While I was driving, Bug was rolling up a joint, and I'm just driving down the road, and I hear Chancey kind of snickering in the back seat, and I hear Bug kind of laughing, and I asked him what was so funny. And they told me not to worry about it, just to keep driving.
They come down to this intersection down here and catch a red light.
this elementary school right here on the northwest corner. You can look over there and see there's actually cameras that's mounted on the east side of this. This school right here captured Chris Lane's last moments alive that we were able to find on camera. We were able to get this video and actually catch Christopher Lane jogging.
Just jogging.
Okay.
Wasn't doing nothing. Wasn't hurting a freaking fly.
Right.
You see Michael Jones's vehicle come through that intersection. So Christopher jogs past here, comes through all the way here, and they're catching up.
This is where I need you to be very, very descriptive, okay? Because there were some things said in the car, right, about him beforehand?
I mean, they called him a goofy-looking nigga. I don't remember what all was said, but they were making fun of him, yeah.
Before you approached him?
Before we drove by, yes, sir.
Okay, and what... When you got up there, who shot him?
Come to a peak of a hill, and then when I got close to Chris, I heard a gunshot.
Where's your emergency?
I'm at the hill, Plato, and there's a young man just fell over in the ditch, and he's got blood on him. He's been shot.
Chancey pulled the trigger.
Did you see it?
I didn't see it, but I know he did.
Did he tell you he did it?
Yes.
He was aiming to kill.
Yes. Yeah. You don't point a gun at somebody and pull the trigger without intending to take their life.
Can you show us how you think it happened?
Right. I am seated where Chancey Luna would have been seated on that day that Christopher Lane was shot. And my back right now is up against the back seat of this vehicle, and I can easily get my arm extended past the headrest and out the window to get a clear shot.
And Chris was only about this far away.
That's correct.
With his back turned.
That's correct.
Like I said, it was with a snub-nosed 22 revolver. He had to have been very close range.
Okay.
Very close range.
I heard him scream.
Who screamed?
Chris Lane. And I looked out my window and I seen him grabbing his back and kinda went to fall, I guess.
And Christopher stumbles across the road and collapses over there in the grass.
Okay, is he in the roadway or is he in the ditch?
No, he's in the ditch. He was standing in the roadway and he fell over, and as I come by, he just fell over in the ditch.
Did you discuss with them why? I mean, surely if you're driving a car when someone gets shot, you would turn around and say, why did you do that?
No, I didn't.
Come on. You just watch somebody shoot somebody on a road and you just didn't even think to say, why did you do that?
No, I really didn't. The only thing I told Chancey was, give me the gun and give me the ammo so I can get rid of it.
Because at this point, I didn't know he killed the man. See, I was under the impression that he shot him in the leg or something like that, just trying to hurt somebody for fun, because he told me that they enjoy hurting people.
What was the reaction in the car from Chancey?
This may sound crazy, but they was excited. They was happy. Their exact words was, you got that nigga, you shot him, you got him, you got him.
The suspects then turned left here at a pretty accelerated rate of speed. And right here, over here on the left-hand side, this house right here, there's an individual, an eyewitness by the name of Richard Rhodes.
You saw the car?
I seen the car come around that corner. I mean, the speed was just unbearable.
What'd you hear?
I heard a loud pop.
A gunshot?
A gunshot, yeah.
You were in no doubt?
No doubt in my mind. I heard that shot, and I seen the car. First thing I did was lift up his shirt, and I seen that hole in his back.
The man that's come around the corner off the Twilight Beach said he's been shot.
You know, and I kept trying to talk to Chris. And I said, hey, buddy, hey, just hang on with me. Just hang on there, bud. About every 30 to 40 seconds, he'd come up and he'd gasp for air.
And they continue to travel down this road right here.
Meanwhile, Chris is dying.
Meanwhile, Chris is on the ground fighting for his life.
See this man right here? His eyes are still open. And he's gasping for his last breath.
He's turning blue, he said.
Is he talking to you right now?
No, he's just, that's all he's doing, making a noise.
All right, you just stay on the line with me, okay?
Okay, well, I want to hear some silence.
Certainly, you never thought to stop and help Chris.
But I never thought of him dying, neither.
He was just 22. He was just out for a jog. It just seems insane that this would happen to him. And I see the tears now, but you know, it's too late. It's just too late.
On August the 16th, 2013, at 2:55 in the afternoon, in a quiet neighborhood in Duncan, Oklahoma, 22-year-old Chris Lane was the victim of a drive-by shooting.
I was off to the grocery store to get some groceries for all the people that was at my house. I turned here, you know, just minding my own business. And I got about here, I was right here, and I saw a body laying face down in the grass. And there was a man kneeling by the body.
He's not conscious. Is he still breathing? Barely.
And so I just pulled over. There was still air. There was still movement in his body. And this man was kept saying, hang on, man, hang on, hang on. People will be here in a minute. Hang on, man. And so I said, you know, I said, if we have to do anything, I said, I've got to turn him over in order to do chest compressions. So I rolled him over. I seen where the bullet went in on his back, you know, his shoulder. And I thought, well, it just looks like a little bullet. Well, you know, maybe just a little hole. And I'm thinking, okay, it's at the shoulder. Maybe it missed everything. And when I rolled him over, I didn't see an exit wound. So I knew the bullet was still in. And his eyes, it was like he was just staring at me. Just great big brown eyes, and they just kept, it was just put that hole in me, just kind of like, help me.
Everyone keeps talking about those big brown eyes looking up.
Yes. They looking right at me, buddy.
That's tough.
Yeah. I still see it every day.
Looking into his eyes, did you know you were losing him?
Somebody said that he was already gone, but you know, in my soul, in my heart, I didn't want to think that, but I couldn't get a pulse.
If you don't hurry, he's gone.
Ma'am, they're coming, okay? Has he stopped breathing?
Has he stopped breathing? Yes. Yes, okay. They say he has. Finally, here's some police.
Okay.
Can I get off? Stop right here, fella. Right here.
Okay.
Can I get off?
You can. Thank you, ma'am.
All right, thank you. Bye.
And it's the sounds of people desperately trying to help Chris.
Yes.
It's hard to hear, isn't it?
Yes. Over the years, we've heard a lot of them, and that one's still hard to listen to.
You, Linda, were the last people that he saw.
I know I was the last one he seen.
I don't know how that sits with you.
Man.
Where did the bullet strike, Chris?
The bullet struck Chris on the left side in the back, and it fractured a rib and entered in between two ribs. It traveled through his left lung to the center of his heart, entered the right lung, exited the right lung, and lodged right on the right under the skin on the right side of his chest.
He didn't have hope.
He had no hope, no.
And then there was that phone call.
And that happened on a Saturday morning. I copped a bit of a sleep in, got a phone call and looked at my phone, and it was the Duncan number. So my first words were, "Hi, mate, how are you?" And it was Cindy, Sarah's mum. And she said, "There's been an incident and Chris has been shot." I said, "How is he? Is he okay?" And she just said, "No, he's dead." So obviously your brain goes into shutdown.
The sheriff told me, I don't remember his name at the moment, but he came in with another guy who was a priest, told me to sit down, and he then showed me a picture of Chris and asked if I knew who he was, and I said I did, and I identified who he was and told him, and then he told me he had been shot, and then I asked if he was okay, and he said no, he did not make it.
There were very few details too. So when we first heard, I think we had been told that he was definitely dead, yeah, and that it was a drive-by.
He just left home. Like, he'd been with us for 3 months. It's awful.
A college baseball player randomly gunned down.
Lane was in town visiting his girlfriend when he was killed. News 9's Lisa Monahan joins us live in Duncan with the latest. Lisa?
If you don't hurry, he's gone.
They're coming, okay? They're on the way.
You've got this whole area. And at that point, we had zero idea.
All that is down here, but EMS, make sure they're
coming. Them boys right there, for what they did, they're wrong.
When I got that call, it was just, hey, a guy has been shot on the side of the road up on Country Club Road. It was just kind of shocking because that's an area that it's typically low crime area. It's a very secluded, quiet place.
The details were very sketchy. We didn't know much.
So it was a black hole of information at that stage.
Yeah, I think calling it a black hole would be a real good way to describe it because, quite frankly, we just didn't know what we had.
Did you honestly think that you were going to get away with it?
At first, yes. I thought that I was going to get away with it because nobody was around.
But somebody was around. Somebody who heard them shoot Chris Lane. Somebody who saw their car and saw what color it was.
You were the only one. I got to see the car.
And you were crucial.
Yes.
So Michael Jones, Chancy Luna, and James Edwards, they proceed this way. They turn right into this parking lot. This is Don Jose's Mexican food restaurant. The security footage is right up there on the southwest corner. You can see it right there. And they proceed northbound and turn back here. And they back in to one of these spaces right here. And they wait and they conceal their weapons and ammunition back there in that parking lot.
That's where I made Chancy give me the gun and the bag of ammunition. I popped my hood, and I took apart my air intake manifold, and I set the .22 caliber revolver under my air filter.
Justin, this is the car used to kill Chris Lane.
Yes, this is the car. Underneath the hood of the vehicle, we were able to recover 104 .22 caliber bullets that had been hastily placed in these two voids here in the fuse box. Also in this air intake, the gun was placed in that area right there.
After hiding the gun and the ammo, the three teenagers took a brazen next step. They headed to the local courthouse, where Bug Edwards had a probation hearing over a petty theft charge.
After they do this shooting, they drive to the court?
Yes. And they proceed to the courthouse to where the courthouse surveillance footage gets them pulling up on the west side of the courthouse. James Edwards gets out and walks in and does his business there.
Here was the plan, take James to court, go to my dad's house, and me and Chancy. At this point, I didn't know he killed the man.
At 13 minutes to 4, at Duncan Regional Hospital, Chris Lane was pronounced dead. With few clues and no apparent motive for his shooting, police were struggling to fathom the crime and fearful his killer or killers had fled town.
All we knew is we were looking for a black car. That car, we knew it was traveling west towards Highway 81, which is a major highway that runs through Duncan. And you know, the thought was that car could be anywhere.
Then, in the late afternoon, Jones and Luna were on the move again. Bizarrely, they headed back towards the murder scene.
And Chancy said, go over there and drive by and see if there's any blood. So I turned around because I seen caution tape and stuff. And he said, Cuz is dead. I killed Cuz.
Who said that?
Chancy.
Right.
Why would he do it?
That's
so
stupid. Luna now realizes he'll be wanted for murder.
And he said, we need to go get rid of this gun.
Jones drives to a place called Elm Terrace, to these apartments, where he and Luna give the gun to a man called Odessa Barnes to dispose of. The gun has never been found. It's now 5:30 in the afternoon. Bug Edwards soon joins them. For the next hour or so, the three teenagers stay here, off the street, out of sight, and out of reach of the police.
I think there was a sinking feeling among all of us in law enforcement that, you know, we're not going to get anybody. We're not going to get anything out of this.
But at the lowest point for the police, Jones, Luna, and Edwards made a breathtakingly stupid decision. They got back in the car to look for another victim to shoot. They knew who they were after, someone who earlier that day had challenged Bug Edwards to a fight.
We went to a church parking lot so Bug could fight a guy named Chris Johnson. Well, Chris texted Bug and said, are you looking for me? And Bug said, yeah. He said, well, I'm to the church parking lot. And Bug said, I'm on my way. And Chris said, all right, well, I have a hot piece of lead for your ass. And Bug said, all right, I'm going to blow your fucking head off, bitch.
Bug just stood outside the car waiting on him. And then I said, dude, he ain't coming. The police is going to be the one coming. Look, his dad's on the phone right now, probably with the cops.
Duncan Police Department.
Yes, I need to get an officer over at 111 West Ash. Some young kids over here with some guns.
Are they play guns or real guns?
My understanding they're supposed to be real guns.
Do you know the names?
0 hours.
I said his name is James Edwards. I see him right here in the parking lot.
I was trying to get him in the car, tell him that he's doing something stupid. Even Chancey, man. Me and Chancey both. Aren't you on probation, bro? He's like, yeah. I was like, come on, dude. Get in the car.
Their arrests were imminent.
As I'm approaching this area right here, I see the black car, and I know that as I pull up, I've seen that car before. I've seen it in the surveillance. We've got them. This is our people. This is our car.
At 7 p.m., just over 4 hours after Chris Lane was shot, police now had the prime suspects for his murder. But who fired the gun and who would break first?
This is where he was last alive, so I like being here.
You and your family took Chris home. How important was it for you to do that?
It was really important.
I can only imagine it must be incredibly painful to do that.
Yeah, but I didn't want him to fly alone.
You'd only just made that journey with him yourself. What do you remember about that flight?
I remember they flew us in a really nice area of the plane, and all I could think about was how Chris always wanted to fly business, and we got to and he didn't.
What do you remember about the day of his funeral?
The sheer overwhelming sense of loss inside. You know, like standing up to iron a shirt to go to Chris's funeral. I mean, I still hate ironing shirts. I mean, I sit there and I will go out of my way not to iron a shirt. But, you know, reading the eulogy, tough. When someone as young as Chris loses their life, it's always a tragedy. But when the life is lost for no purpose and with no logic, much, much harder to understand and accept. Asking the son-in-laws and some of his mates to carry the coffin, there's just a whole lot of horrendous triggers. But by the same token, grateful that so many people would come out and say goodbye to your son. You knew he'd made a mark and you knew that he'd touched people along the way.
It's been reported that you told police that the reason this happened was you were bored.
See, I don't even know where that come from because I never told the police anything of that sort.
Why did somebody shoot him?
Boredom, I guess.
Boredom, I guess.
Boredom. Did they do it because they were bored?
That's what Michael indicated. Quit clicking them. I don't want to mess up our audio. I want to be able to hear you, not the clicking of the handcuffs, okay?
I was working about 3.5 hours away from home. And somebody said that, did y'all hear about a young man getting shot today?
Okay, I'm gonna read you what your rights are, same stuff you've heard on TV before, okay?
And about 10 minutes later, I got the phone call from my wife. And I fell down and started crying. And a co-worker brought me home. And I tried to go see him, and they wouldn't let me see him.
You don't want to talk?
No, I'm away from my parents.
Don't need your parents.
You needed to break one of them. You needed one of them to start talking to.
Correct. We knew we had the right three, and then it was a matter of sorting out levels of culpability. Who was the shooter? Who was the driver? Who, you know, what level of participation did each one of them have?
Do you know that you're in a lot of trouble?
Yeah, I was afraid so.
It's interesting to watch his demeanor. In the first interview, he seemed cocky.
Right.
The second and third interviews, you start to see him break down.
Right.
You have the right to talk to your lawyer and have him present with you while you're being questioned.
Can I have him present now?
If you wish to have him present, do you wish to have him now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We are finished.
Damn. Seriously?
Michael, if you want an attorney, I can't ask you anything because I cannot get him here now, okay?
Okay.
I'm not going to pressure you in any way, by any means, okay? I'm not going to do anything that you do not want me to do, okay? And if you want an attorney here, we're going to have to figure out what all's going on and get him up here, okay?
I just want to go home to my wife. I didn't kill nobody.
Okay, Michael. But I need you to understand. Okay, this is why I have Justin here. This is Justin Scott with the DA's office. Okay, he's an investigator with them. Okay?
We could see him weeping, saying, I just want to go home.
Right.
Was that him being scared? Was that him protecting himself? Was that remorse?
I think it's a combination of being scared and trying to protect himself.
If you do, if I do allow you to ask me questions and I tell you everything, is that going to get you home to my court date?
I cannot guarantee you anything like that, Michael. I cannot. I cannot say you can walk out of here right now.
In Oklahoma, another big story involving gun violence is getting a lot of attention because of the shocking nature of the crime and the reason police say a group of teenagers killed a young man in cold blood. A stranger who was just out for a jog.
Can you say why you did it? Why Chris Lane?
There was not a seat left empty in the courtroom this afternoon. Among the crowd...
Is there anything you want to say?
I don't want to say no.
Please move.
It's probably going to be harder and longer than we thought.
Do you show remorse for what happened?
I am appalled at the behavior of these three children.
I remember seeing you in that first court appearance. How hard was it to come face to face with these? Three.
It was hard, but it was also sad that people that young can be that cruel. But at the same time, I was also angry.
We feel appropriately satisfied that this was not a premeditated murder.
The two lawyers for Chancey and Jones argued the murder was an accident.
These young fellows thought there were blanks in this .22 gun. There was a swerving, could have gone off accidentally.
The judge and jury didn't buy it. Chancey Luna, who was 16 when he shot and killed Chris Lane, was sentenced to life in jail with no chance of parole.
You were in court when Chancey Luna was found guilty.
Mm-hmm.
What was that moment like?
I think we all knew it was coming. So it wasn't like it was shock as much as kind of relieving that it was over and it was put to rest, I guess.
It doesn't change the fact we don't take Chris home. It doesn't change the fact of what happened. So yes, it's a result, but it's not a good result or a bad result. It's just a result.
I
sat and listened to the trial, and I watched him at the trial. He's just gutless. He shoots somebody in the back and then he can't face their family.
Have you got a message for the Lanes? This is your chance to say sorry.
I'm sorry.
What was that?
I'm sorry.
He can't look at the wall where the autopsy pictures are. He's just a coward.
James, do you think you deserve this?
James Bug Edwards, the front seat passenger in the car that day, was sentenced to 25 years, but may serve as little as 5 years after he turned state's evidence. After his sentencing, he had these words for Chris's family.
Do you want to apologise to them for your role in this, though?
Yes, ma'am, I do. And I am very sorry about what has happened. It's very unfortunate what has happened, but, you know, I just hope that something good will come out of all of this, and, you know, maybe that, I don't know, man.
Why did you pick him?
It's tough.
Why Chris?
What do you mean?
Why did Chris have to die? Why him?
I never chose for Chris to die at all, so, you know what I mean? That's a question you're not going to have to ask me. You have to ask somebody else.
2 weeks after Chris's murder, the teenage girlfriend of Michael Jones gave birth to their baby daughter.
Chances are I won't be alive to get to see him when he gets out. So the only way that I'm going to get to hug or kiss my son is over a yellow line for a minimum of 20 or 30 seconds.
Miss him?
I miss him a lot.
I guess, you know, the Lane family don't get to have visits.
No, they don't. But I will tell you that at least once or twice a month, I drive down by the memorial and I say a prayer for the Lane family. From what I understand, he was a very good young man, very promising young man. I wish I would have got to meet him.
The question I still don't understand is why, Michael? Why? Why did Chris have to die?
I don't know. I literally can't answer that because I don't know.
It's hard because I do. I think of the family a lot. And, that's the hardest part of it. That knowing that, you know, a young man lost his life over nothing.
Hold on, hold up to me, 'cause I'm little unsteady. Little unsteady.
Chris had got the balance right.
He had so many plans, Sarah and him had so many plans.
Someone as young as Chris loses their life, it's always tragic. To fight when you feel
like flying. That's stupid. If you love me,
don't let go. I think of the family a lot. That's the hardest part of it. If you love me,
don't let go. Miss him. Sad.
Sorry.
I like being here.
If giving up my son's life would bring back theirs, I would gladly do that.
Little unsteady.
I want to show you a photo. I think it's important. You obviously know who that is. What do you know about Chris?
I know he went to school at Ada, and I knew he was good at baseball.
He was on a trip of a lifetime, on a baseball scholarship, just met the love of his life, and you helped end all of that. The Lane family are never going to see Chris again. They'll never get to see him again. Well, we're hopefully going to show them this. Here's your chance. If you wanted to say something to them, what would you say to them?
You know, I know I've put y'all through a lot, you know. There's nothing I can say or do to ever change what happened. But I do hope that they can find it, you know, to forgive me, you know. I tell them that I really am truly sorry, and I know they're never gonna see Chris again, and that's something that not only them, but I have to live with, because they're not ever gonna see Chris again at my hands. You know, I may not have pulled the trigger, but I drove away, and that's just as bad.
Is this something you think about every day in here?
Every day.
Anything?
I still want to believe, you know. I don't know, and I'm sorry. You know, I you know, he didn't stop. He didn't get out of the car. He didn't. He wasn't with him. He was prepared to let my son die on his own. You know, it's justice. That's where he is for his actions.
No sympathy whatsoever. He made a conscious choice. He swerved the car. He knew what he was doing. And Margaret being sorry after the event. Don't do the action. Don't listen to your dickhead mates. Actually, you know, grow up. Act like you're 16. And look, apologising is nothing. He didn't testify against Luna. He traded out for his own arse. So, no sympathy, no care.